Groovy.
This is Groovy Spoilers.
Yes! This
is Spoilers. I'm your host, Pappy, and that evil laugh at the end of the intro means this is the season of Spooky Spoilers.
Huzzah!
Joining me today, we have Babyface Brett. Self-anointed Babyface Brett. How's it going, man?
Pretty good, man.
Brett, how often do you get carded?
More often than I should for being 34 years old.
Brett, what was your state of mind going into Spooky Spoilers 2018? Were you spooked? Were you nervous?
No, I was pumped. I didn't get a lot of spooky action last year. I missed a lot of those ones, so I'm excited to be hopefully a little more involved this time.
Do you like horror? You always bragged about how you were never scared as a baby. I don't know if that's carried over into adulthood.
So many things. I don't like horror movies, but this was not scary, so I'm good so far.
Stevie, you jumped in and asked Brett a question there. You're recording from Elkhart.
I am.
Why do we do so many horror comedies? Why is it so fun to talk about?
They're just hysterical to talk about. I think one of the first ones I did is What We Do in the Shadows. And I think it's just fun to have like gory movies with comedy behind it. I don't understand what's so hard to understand. Like, I feel like I'm going to be defending this movie all night.
These guys, dukes up, ready to go.
God, I'm ready to go because I love this trilogy. But yeah, let's do it.
What's your favorite horror comedy?
Quadrigy. Real quick.
Favorite horror comedy?
Horror comedy.
What We Do in the Shadows.
Nice.
Like, I go to that movie quite a bit just for happiness.
Mike, you were on the What We Do in the Shadows episode, right?
Yeah.
What's your favorite horror comedy? We've done a lot, and you've picked Beetlejuice last year. That was a good horror comedy.
Yeah, Beetlejuice is pretty good. Like Stevie said, Army of Darkness is another one in this trilogy that I actually own. That's pretty good. That's got a lot of crazy special effects in that. I would probably say Army of Darkness is really fun to watch. But like, also Friday the 13th is really fun to watch with friends. Get really drunk watching too. It's really funny.
I would love to get some friends someday so I can watch Friday the 13th. Jordan, you hail from the land where Evil Dead 2 was shot, North Carolina, and you were also recently hit by a hurricane. Our audience has been sending their thoughts and prayers your way.
Heaven for Devin.
Doing? How are you doing, Jordan?
I mean, it's the wettest we've been in terms of water today.
Jordan's so wet.
But I mean, all proceeds of this podcast are going to victims of Hurricane Florence, so I'm pretty happy about
negative
that.
Negative $50.
That's good to hear. And then let's go last, but certainly not least, Yo Bueva, according with Mikey. Josh, I remember you saying on the first Evil Dead how you wished it was more like this movie. Do you remember how old you were when you saw this movie, Evil Dead 2?
You know what? I haven't even seen this movie before, and I didn't realize that.
You lied.
So you lied.
I was mistaking
to everybody.
This for Evil Dead 3, Army of Darkness. Which
no
I
one calls
this
it
was,
Evil Dead 3.
You fucking serious?
Which I thought it was until like 15 minutes into this movie.
So how old were you when you first saw it? Like 42?
I was in college, and actually Kyle McVeigh showed it to me.
Friend of the pod.
Yeah, Oklahoma City Bomber?
If I can piggyback on what they were talking about earlier, though, about horror comedies, I think it was Please. Stevie chose one last year, and it was the first time I'd seen it. It's by far my favorite ever. It's Cabin in the Woods.
Oh, yeah.
Ooh, that is such a good movie. Awesome.
Pappy
but Josh,
that.
You have to like this movie, because Cabin in the Woods wouldn't freaking exist if not for this movie.
Pappy the tree one. From Cabin in the Woods is in this.
There you go.
He reprises his role.
He's actually the tree's son.
Nepotism. Well, again, in Hollywood.
Josh, you were on Evil Dead 1 last year. Let's just jump right into it. How do you reconcile the fact this is Evil Dead 2, but... Well, do you want to talk about the intro? Like, what happens? It's so confusing. It's like the same thing, right?
The intro is like a quick recap retelling of the first movie.
Are you reading Wikipedia right now?
Who?
You.
No. No.
No. I'm saved by Mikey drinking. What are you talking about?
Stiff
Brother
drink.
Jordan.
Wikipedia. The movie opens with a brief recap of the first movie.
That's exactly what I have too.
But dude, it does.
I can confirm.
Josh Long knows the best.
He's
words.
Not reading Wikipedia.
What I was gonna say that confuses me though is that Ash is like a reoccurring character, but like somehow the events from the last movie don't take place in this timeline. So
it's
really,
not what
it's just
it is.
Like. It's like a quick remake of the last
it's
movie.
It's a requel.
Should it be like Evil Dead Point 2? Like version 2?
I was thinking it was either an anthology or ooh. I have a theory later that I'll get
Cloverfield.
To.
Cloverfield. Ooh.
A theory. Ooh.
He has a theory, but he's going to save like... it. He's going to, yeah.
Saving it for the pod. Later in this pod.
After the ads.
So, Josh, so what kind of just well, for our audience, you were on Evil Dead 1 last year. Just recap what happens in this first little montage so we have a place to start.
It starts with them driving in the woods through the countryside, and they're like, we're going to go to this cabin, and we don't know much about it. And they get to the cabin, and kind of towards the middle of the other of Evil Dead 1, he has to decide to like kill his girlfriend. Or maybe that's towards the end. I don't really remember, but that happens like immediately. In this movie, he has to like slice his girlfriend's head off. And we got some bags early in this movie, but they're like dead bags.
Claymation phenomenal
dead,
bags.
Gross bags.
Stop motion bags.
Hey, bags are bags.
Is that it? I mean, what else happens, though, Pappy? There?
I mean, yeah, it happens so fast. It has like a frenetic pace, and it's just this quick transition with the shovel, and he's buried. And then, like, I don't understand the days in this movie, because then it's just, like, the daytime all of a
well,
sudden.
Well, that's how the first movie ended.
Yeah, that's a good
well,
point.
Well, ended... What?
I was going to say, you have been chiming in here like you have the answers. I can't wait for you to explain what Evil Dead 1, 2, like the common thread that ties them together.
So they wanted to do a recap of the first movie with just like a mashup of the actual footage they used, but they didn't have the rights to do so. And so they like pretty much retold the first movie as quickly as possible. And when he's flying through the air and lands is when like 2 officially starts. Does that make sense? Because the movie ends, the first movie ends with daytime and evil coming upon him, and it's just him screaming.
Why didn't they just say previously on Lost?
Because it's the 80s, the decade you and Brett are from, crusty ass decade.
But actually, the intro titles reminded me of Lost. It's like a slow zoom on those letters. I don't know if anyone else noticed that. Lost.
Good show.
And the smoke ABC. Monster.
Ooh. Ooh.
I also enjoyed the part where Ash turns into an airplane propeller, though.
Yes.
Reminded me of like a Peter Gabriel music video.
Doesn't
for all you 80s kids.
Doesn't
yeah!
Crash Bandicoot doesn't Crash Bandicoot fly through the air like that at some point? Yeah. So that's officially what happens, Stevie, is they're retelling like the last 15 minutes of the first movie?
Yeah, because they couldn't get the rights to show like a mashup of like what happened. So they just had to reshoot it and kind of do like a requel. Where it's like, we're going to remake the first one, but then we're going to tell the second one as fast as possible.
Does that work for you, Pappy, in any way?
I was pretty confused.
I liked it. I like how it's not even explained either. Like, I like that it's just an audience sitting down, because they could have just called it like evil. They could have just called it Death by Dawn, and it would have been like soft reboot culture. You know what I mean? Like Jurassic World style, where it's like, is this the same universe? I'm confused. But there's like, fuck you, audience, figure it out. It's Evil Dead 2. And they make a point of it. Evil Dead 2.
They didn't really put the. It's just Evil Dead 2.
Evil Dead 2. But yeah, so then, like I said, though, like Ash gets thrown across the woods and it instantly becomes night again. And he's possessed by an evil creature, which I love the practical effects. Brett, I know you're a hater on this movie. Could you at least appreciate the costuming that was done and the prosthetics and the makeup?
Yeah, sure. No, I mean...
That hurts, boy. Brett.
Explanation, Brett. Good job.
I mean, be specific. Which part are you talking about?
This is like when he's possessed. The makeup on actually, Ash, where he has the white-out contacts where they couldn't even see anything.
It's where he looks like Paul Rudd.
The stuff on him was a lot better than the other stuff. Like, I thought he actually looked pretty good.
He was the best zombie by far. He was, like, really twitchy and good at that. I enjoyed that.
Yeah, he was pretty good.
That's pretty good. All right, and then there's this great shot, too, of a tracking shot where the demon is, like, chasing Ash through the house, and they knock down the doors for, like, the first of, like, 10 times in this movie. The doors just keep getting knocked down.
That was good. That was good. I enjoyed that.
That was a maze of a shot. It was fun to watch.
But they're, like, they're literally running through, like, the back lot of the set. Like, you can see, like, the wires at one point. And, like, because I watched the making of, they're like, yeah, he wasn't supposed to, like, go over there. Like, they're running through, like, the wires. And, like, if you look closely, you can see, like, people just standing around, like, in the shot. It's like, what? Brett, it's that sweet, sweet schlock that makes this movie so lovable. But I'm going to have you describe Annie and Ed, because I think this is kind of maybe a flaw of the movie, because we have two storylines going on, and we cut to the airport. How would you describe these two characters, Brett?
They're the corny-looking blonde guy and the main chick, right? They're going to meet her parents, who have discovered this death book, and they're just...
It's the book of the dead.
Two other strangers, you know, two pretty good looking women in a demonic forest. It's kind of weird, but I don't know. I don't know.
Did the split storylines bother you? Did it feel like it slowed it down? Because that would be one of my only complaints with the movie, is that it's going at such a breakneck pace in the cabin.
Yeah, and
we have to grind back to the airport a couple
times.
Yeah,
that's kind of what it felt like. The Harbinger. It almost felt like a cartoon where Bruce Campbell was. Like, I could hear, like, Wizard of Oz music. Like he's just kind of going around going nuts. So it was just kind of weird. It was, like, really bland storyline between two really boring people and, like, Bruce Campbell, who's doing his darndest to kill things, and he's being all spastic. And it was weird. You're right. I don't think I noticed it until you brought it up.
I feel like those characters were trying to fix what sucked about the first movie, and that, like, there was this book of the... It was, like, trying to tie more threads into, like, actually putting a story and, like, a quest behind the book instead of it just being an object. So the whole thing with her, like, reading it and, like, almost stopping the whole thing at the end. It's kind of like what drives the plot. So at least Evil Dead 2 does have a plot, where I'm not sure Evil Dead 1 has, like, any plot.
I was so happy when they came in with the other storyline. Because the first 30, 40 minutes of this movie is exactly the same as the other one. It's him getting, like, tossed around by this smoke monster or whatever it is. And I needed something to kind of, it's the Evil Dead. I needed something to kind of drive some new kind of story. But sorry,
some
Mike,
some kind of story.
You. Some kind
Anything.
Of story. Yeah.
Something.
No, it's just that I thought that these characters were just brought in to, like, explain the lore of the book or whatever, mm-hmm. to kind of shed some light on how the book kind of works or something. Just so, I mean, in the first movie, there's just a book. You don't know anything about the book, and then there's zombies everywhere. So this time around, they just explain it a bit more.
And there are still zombies everywhere.
All right, well, let's cut back to the cabin, the part that Jordan hates, and one of my favorite sequences of the whole movie. Things are kind of starting to get a little weird, you could say. Ash is starting to lose his mind.
I love when he's dancing with the lamps. A little bit. And like the light shades and stuff. That is so awesome.
That's the best part. And like he sits down in a rocking chair, and then Linda's head just like falls from the top of the set. I don't know. And like lands in his lap. And then we go to the woodshed for the first time. Jordan, do you remember what happens with Linda's head here in the woodshed?
Yeah, he puts it in like a vise, and then it suddenly turns back into normal Linda, and he almost holds back from sawing her ass or her face in half. But then he proceeds to saw it in half, and blood covers every inch of the inside of that woodshed and the light bulb included. So it's all red and weird. And
such an iconic shot, that light bulb.
It is.
Even now, she burns in hell.
Well, it's used a lot for our Evil Dead stuff. Like, that light bulb covered in blood, it's used a lot just to, like, show, like, Evil
it's
Dead
also
stuff.
In Mother, Stevie. You just watched that movie. Remember when they're in the basement and the light bulb gets filled up with blood?
It's that a total movie, homage to this. Don't know how to feel about that movie.
Is this the first movie that did this?
Well, it's in the Evil Dead 1 as well.
Yeah, and it's also in Ash vs. Evil Dead. So, yeah.
The old self riff. Love it.
Yep. Playing the greatest hits.
Please, Ash. Please don't hurt me. You swore that we'd always be together. I love you. No!
There is a great part in that shed, though, and they were talking about it in the documentary, or the making of, and it's the effects guys, basically, if you watch the making of, and it's just kind of them bullshitting around, like recalling their times on the set when they were like way younger and just kind of crazy asses, but they were like reading the script, and they're like, oh, dude, so this woman comes in and her head's been cut off and she comes in with a chainsaw and it's going to be so scary. And then they get on set and Sam Raimi's like, all right, get the Muppet in here. It's a plastic chainsaw with a Muppet. Like, this is not what I was expecting.
Get the Muppet in here.
All right. But Brett, we didn't mention Jake and Bobby Joe. Do you want to talk about them a little bit? Because they're about to come into the story in a big way.
Well, the two other people are stuck at that bridge that's broken, and what's the guy's name?
Jake.
Kind of a, I don't know,
Jake
hillbilly,
Ryan.
Hillbilly-ish. And then Bobby
Jake
Joe just creeps
Trump.
Up out of nowhere. And they're kind of, they're both kind of mean, but they take them on this trail to get them to the house, and that's where they kind of disappear for a while.
They're kind of a mismatched couple.
Yes, was not.
He's punching above his weight.
Is there some incest being implied here?
She was definitely too good looking for him, and he was just a Billy Bob. I don't know.
I gave them backstories, but yeah, it didn't seem like they went together at all.
What were their backstories you gave them?
I figured he was a wealthy pig farmer and she ran away from home.
What the shit?
Pig farmer?
Basic. Dude, they make a lot of money, I'm just saying.
Nothing tames the heart of a young runaway woman like a
young runaway, like a pig farmer with lots of money.
It's a pig conglomerate.
This is exactly what I ran away from.
The titan
home
of industry.
For.
Yeah, exactly. That's the backstory I gave them.
That's pretty good. I like that.
Hey. I just remembered. But yeah, that's right. There is a trail. You could follow Bobby Joe and me.
Sounds all right to me.
But it'll cost you.
How much?
45. 100 bucks.
Tell you what, you take my bags and you got a deal.
All right, well, back in the cabin, one of my favorite running gags, and like I think one of the best parts of the little movie is the hands, the things that go on with the hand.
This
is exactly where it happens in the story. Josh, I bet you appreciate this too. Do you want to talk about the hand a little bit?
Yeah, Bruce Campbell is really called on here by the director to do some serious acting and have his hand attack him for about 5 minutes. It's pretty convincing.
It's so great.
And it ends in like a really satisfying, like, he's happy to cut off his hand by the end of it. Like, he's joyfully slicing and dicing his own arm. I think that's what's the most enjoyable part about it, is like Ash's over the top resolve and like him kind of going crazy and just like embracing the ride. It's kind of like what Stevie talked about earlier, where he starts dancing and laughing with all the inanimate objects. He's just like losing his mind, but like going for the ride. And Pappy, sorry to derail, but quick question.
Yo.
There's like a brief moment in this movie where they act like they're going to go down the road of like, he's just crazy and this is in his head. And they like, they yeah. left that pretty quick. But what did you think about that?
That was actually my crackpot theory of the reconciling of the two storylines, that everything that that Ash was seeing was actually like his like delusions, that he's just totally lost it. And that up until when Bobby Joe and Jake, when he accidentally shoots Bobby Joe, that's just like him kind of like spazzing out like a crazy.
This was my theory too. So
nice, Mikey. Ooh. Yeah. Sorry, I didn't mean to steal your thunder.
Because in the beginning, I thought he just lapses in memory or something and brings people up to this cabin and murders them because he has delusions that they've turned into a demon or something. And so he's like subconsciously justifying mm-hmm. it because
who's like Memento. Evil.
Yeah. Yeah. He's incepting himself up there in that cabin to kill these people.
I'll say this too. And I think Sam Raimi's pretty freaking lucky on a lot of levels, but he's pretty lucky that Bruce Campbell was one of his best friends and is also happens to be one of like the best slapstick kind of comedians that I've seen, you know what I mean, of the 80s. Like, he's flipping himself around, smashing plates in his face. I love it.
Do you think Jim Carrey pulls from him sometimes?
The hand thing is the claw from Liar Liar.
And like his eyes, I don't know, there's something there.
It's the exact same thing. I don't know, that's what I thought, but he does a lot of like physical comedy and stuff, so I think that's like something to admire, because not everybody can do that. He's tossing himself around this kitchen and stuff and breaking stuff across his head, so
I enjoyed
I didn't mention that.
Hey Pappy. I enjoyed the hand dragging him across the floor. I thought that looked really cool.
Yeah, why does his hand talk?
Did he get that from like? No, that's Adam. I was thinking Adam's Family. That's It and Cousin Thing combined.
That was the best part of the movie for me, and I got to think that Bruce Campbell has been doing some bouldering too, just dragging his whole body across the floor
with his fingers.
Yeah.
Bruce Campbell's seen higher so many times. Listen to the podcast.
His so strength is outrageous.
Stevie, is the hand actually saying anything? There, or is it just mumbly?
I think it's just, like mumbling.
Yeah,
that's like the way I always took it. And I love when he stabs it.
I thought he caught a couple words.
Well, which I thought I heard the F word one time. That's all I thought I heard. But I love the part where he stabs it through the hand and eventually goes at it with the chainsaw. Which I mean, I think the hand part is probably my favorite part of the whole movie.
Yeah,
is it? Is that where he has a look on his face and he's just getting soaked in blood and he's like smiling with the chainsaw?
Yeah, yeah, he's doing the who's laughing now.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, the blood was when he shot the hand through the wall and it all shot out at him, right?
Mm. Yeah,
when like flips him off.
The knife part.
When it goes from like red to black and sucks back in.
Yeah,
yep.
Mm-hmm. Steve, is there anything else about them going crazy you wanted to say, or should we get into where Henrietta comes into the story?
Sweet, sweet Henrietta.
Because I know Ash going crazy is your favorite part.
I mean, do you really think he was going crazy? It was like delusions and none of that was happening?
I don't know. I mean, like, did you like the claymation? Like the scenes? Because that's part of it too, right? Like out in the woods. I know Brett hated it. He wrote that in his Letterboxd review. He gave this movie a half a star.
He hates the claymation?
Whoa!
You gave it half a star, Brett?
Spoiler alert!
A half a star. The lowest possible you can give a movie is what Brett gave this. There's nothing redeeming in this film at all.
Hey, nothing redeeming, Brett.
I just want to point something out that Brett's favorite vegetable is a potato.
What is wrong with, I mean, it's not really a vegetable. It's kind of a joke, but Pappy, man, selling me out.
I don't know. Hey. What about the claymation, Brett? You hated it so much. There's that lady dancing in the woods or whatever. Was that so bad?
First of all, I don't like claymation at all. There's a movie I really liked as a kid, and rewatching it, it's so bad because the claymation's so bad. I just don't like it.
Mac and Me?
God, no. Clash
You've
of
lost
Titans.
Your childhood wonder. You've lost
hey,
it.
If you guys, hey, if you talk this movie up and make me think twice about it, it might get a full star, okay?
What was that movie, Brett?
No, Brett, but like...
That you hated?
I feel like there's a lot of great production that goes into this movie.
Clay Fighters for SNES?
That's a good game. Clash of the Titans.
Oh.
That's like
I
a
mean,
classic
does anybody
movie,
else think
it?
Like they pulled off a lot of great... Like, a lot of great, just, like, visual effects were pulled off. I mean, I don't know how they did half of it. Like, I meant, like, practical effects.
Let's talk about a great practical effect in Henrietta, because this is where she shows up. So, like I mentioned, Ash accidentally shoots Billy Joe, or whatever her name is, and then he gets thrown in the basement, and the party comes to realize that it's actually a haunted cabin, and that Henrietta's buried in the basement, and everyone starts screaming "Dead by Dawn." Henrietta was actually played by Sam Raimi's brother, and they were talking about how difficult it was to be in the those prosthetics. And at one point, at the end of shooting, they take off this foot that he was wearing, Henrietta's foot, and they turn it upside down, and there's like a waterfall of sweat fucking pours out.
No.
Jordan, how would you describe the look of Henrietta for someone who has never seen Evil Dead before? What does she look like?
Out of 10. 10
Bruce
out of
Valanche.
10. Yeah.
Bruce Valanche. Hot or not? Swipe left or right?
I mean, definitely swipe
super like
right. I mean, she is bloated, I would say, is the word.
So hot.
Grotesque.
So soft.
I think that the claymation towards the end when she like grows a 20-foot neck is pretty good. The rest of the time she like you can kind of just see her head poking through the cellar door, and that's also pretty gross.
Yeah,
there's a point when her head grows where it looks exactly like a scene I've seen in an old movie where like a dinosaur is fighting like a caveman. It's really horrible looking.
Yeah.
Actually.
Yeah.
What?
Is that the part where it starts making the monkey noises, too? Like,
oh, yeah. Those are definitely monkey noises.
Gosh, I know exactly what you're talking about.
It's like claymation and, like, the... Yeah. The person isn't interacting with it very well.
It's like the original Jurassic Park movie from 1918. That's what it looks like.
What?
Go look it up. Go look it up.
What?
A silent film. A silent movie from, like, the early 1910s.
It was called Jurassic Park?
Yep.
It was not called... Really?
Yes, 100%.
Is it called Dinosaurs, A Fun-Filled Trip Back in Time?
So this is the second reboot of Jurassic Park? Yeah.
Pretty much. I
didn't even know about dinosaurs back then. Jurassic Park, 19...
Brett, how many stars did you give it on Letterboxd? Probably more than half a star?
I haven't seen it.
Oh.
Where the heck is this stupid movie?
Yeah, Josh, I know what you're talking about.
Pappy, that half a star is hurting you right now.
Gosh dang it, I better find this.
Not as much as trying to Google Jurassic Park 1918 is hurting the flow of this podcast.
It really is, but it's bothering me because I feel like Brett is just peddling lies.
If we had Chuck Freebie right now, he'd be able to get us back on track really quickly.
The master of segues.
That's what we need. Well, actually, that's kind of funny because the movie... does kind of slow to a halt at this point. Yeah. Ash gets out of the basement, and then like things really slow down.
Dang it.
Right when they're going into the bedroom. It's like a 24-second, like, at least, maybe even more, like, pause as he goes into the bedroom. Huh. And then Bobby Joe and Jake, like, pop in the bedroom. And then the ghost of... Oh, God. Sorry. What's her name? The ghost
Nobi?
Of Annie's father shows up, and he's like... You need to read the pages and save my soul.
I actually kind of like that part. By the way, it's called The Lost World. I apologize. It's from 1925.
Man.
It's okay. It's Arthur Conan Doyle. So I was kind of right.
So you got the name wrong and the year wrong.
Isn't that the movie that Will Ferrell remade?
That's Land of the Lost.
Yeah.
Same thing.
Stacks.
Anyway, let's keep going.
That was the reboot.
I actually kind of like that ghost part you're talking about, Pappy. I don't know why. It's really corny, but I don't know.
Because it reminds you of Star Wars.
Which part?
The sacred texts. The sacred texts. Only you can say.
H. Turner's there or not.
Mother, woman, mercy.
Father?
Penny. There is a dark spirit here that wants to destroy you. Your salvation lies there. The pages of the book. Recite the passages. Dispel the evil. Save my soul. In your own mind.
So then Bobby Joe like disappears, and we see that she's being sucked into the trees.
That was amazing.
Jordan, do you want to talk about the lack of rape in this movie compared to the first one?
They nerfed the trees.
They nerfed the trees.
I was so happy about the their restraint in not showing the tree rape in this movie. Evil Dead 1.
The implication.
Way too much tree rape in that one.
Lots of implication.
I was glad they left it out this time.
It looked like it was about to happen. I'm glad they kind of went away from it.
I fully expected
it. Yeah, they ripped her shirt.
What happens to Bobby Joe exactly? Because she kind of just disappears. She kind of disappears.
A tree eats her.
But that's the end of it? She doesn't come back as a zombie or anything?
She gets smash cut to the Necronomicon.
What did Sam Raimi say? That scene was envisioned for a man, and it was going to be a lot more brutal. It was going to rip him in half, but since it was a woman, they made it less.
Tomahawk.
Pretty much.
Well, Jake is useless the rest of the movie, so why don't they just have him get split in half?
He's That'd a pig farmer. You can't kill him off that quickly.
They need
quickly.
Him to provide a geyser of blood.
True.
He has the most blood. For
he
the
has
later.
To stick around to get stabbed straight in the gut from his only ally in the movie.
He does have a lot of blood. I think we did forget to talk about the part where like the blood just shoots out of the fucking wall. Did we? It's like a geyser.
How many different colors of blood are in this movie?
There's black.
Green.
There's red.
It looks like there's fruit punch there's and green. Then there's ink black. Those are the two colors I was spotting.
There's like green, red. I think there's some blue in there somewhere. Black.
There's some blue. Yeah.
Just, but there are different shades of red. Let's just talk about red for a little while. Soda pop, punch.
You guys, not all demon blood is the same.
All demon blood matters.
Well, a guy is forced to spill a lot of blood in the rest of the movie. Brett, what did you send to the group thread? Brett just posted a picture in the middle of the podcast.
It's
what
Jurassic
is it, Brett?
Park, The Lost World, 1912.
Brett won't let it die.
Kill it if you
must,
Brett.
That's Jake getting stabbed.
Like I was, oh, wow, it's a gif.
Nice. They have gifs back then?
Like I was saying, yeah, Jake gets stabbed here. In this next scene, and it's kind of a cool scene because it like parallels earlier when Bobby Joe got shot. It's like a mistaken identity. Annie thinks that it's Ash who's back to being possessed. So Jake kind of gets his comeuppance for losing his mind and making everyone go look for Bobby Joe. He's like drug across the floor after he gets stabbed, and then I don't know, like, what exactly happens to him with Henrietta? Is she, like, eating him? Because it's another bloody moment. Like, it shoots out of the basement.
So with a giant geyser, I think she just bit him straight in the jug, and that's how much blood happens when you get cut there.
I think she shape-shifted into a wood chipper.
That's the only logical explanation I have.
Right.
No, she turned into a wood chipper, and Steve Buscemi'd.
I think she turned his insides into his outsides and threw him outside.
Right before that, there's like a 30-second scene of the lead female dragging him across the floor and like yelling at him to shut up. Which is like a really weird scene, too.
Shut up. Just shut up.
She's getting like more frustrated, even though she's the one that stabbed him. And he's like, I can't breathe. Shut up. So weird.
Check outside the windows. Check the windows, he's probably right.
But Ash is cured by the power of love because he finds the necklace that he originally gave Linda. And then he has to persuade an Ash-wielding Annie that he's okay.
That was hilarious.
Then probably the best sequence in the movie, Stevie, as you said, what Edgar Wright holds or owes his own career to. They get ready to carve themselves up a witch. Do you want to describe that sequence, Stevie?
I'm not saying this is the first movie to ever do it, but I imagine Edgar Wright, it's something Edgar Wright would have a career, but it wouldn't be the same. It's very identical to what Edgar Wright does in all of his movies. They do like quick cuts of different things. And he's like assembling his like his chainsaw. He's getting a sawed off shotgun ready, doing like minor different like they do a couple different power tools in the mix. But I mean, there's very quick cuts, which Edgar Wright has based his whole career off of.
It's kind of like close-up sound effect. Close-up sound effect.
Yes, close-up sound effect. Close-up sound effect. Yeah.
I feel like Guy Ritchie does that sometimes too. But I like it. I really like that style of editing.
Yeah, I thought it was really well done in this movie. And I love the part where he chops off his sawed-off shotgun. And what's the actress's name? Is it Annie?
Annie
looks super aroused at that point.
Even though her boyfriend died like an hour ago.
Dude, he's not Ashley Williams, all right? It's all upgrade. That matters.
Total upgrade, Bruce Campbell.
Yes.
And this, of course, has like the most iconic line of the movie.
Groovy.
Groovy. Jordan, I know you didn't like this movie. What was your gut reaction when Ash said groovy? Was it, fuck this movie? Did it make you smile?
I mean, this was the part of the movie where I started to laugh a lot more. So kind of starting with...
There we go.
There you go.
Yeah, no, I mean, the second half of the movie was...
Oh, my God.
It was a lot different. I laughed a lot, actually.
You can have fun with movies?
That's what it's all about, Mikey. No, I thought it was good.
Do you like how they linger on his face for like 5 seconds after he says it and his jaw's just kind of working?
Chewing imaginary gum.
Did anyone else catch before they like even go in the shed to say carve up a witch, they show Ash and Army of Darkness? Like in the drawing on the text?
In the prophecy.
She's like, they say he fell from the skies and it's Ash with a chainsaw and a shotgun.
I took a screenshot of that and will post that on Instagram.
I mean, what a great build up to your third movie.
He's such a cute little like cartoon character too, Ash. It's like a little smile on his face, which is not the way he looks.
He has the same ripped clothes. It's awesome. Yeah.
But he has kind of a meta line there too.
Meta.
Wait, what?
He has kind of a... Would you call this a meta movie? Would you describe this as a meta movie, Josh?
I don't know, but he has a funny line where he's like, that guy's kind of an idiot. Something when he sees that picture. They're like, he didn't finish the job. I gotta finish the job.
So like I said, he carves up the witch in the final fight. He tosses a stack of loose leaf paper up to April, miraculously up a flight of stairs, and it stays together. But then
that's old paper, Pat. That's papyrus.
I guess. Yeah, so Right Way is walking up the stairs when he thinks it's done. The witch grabs him, and the Ents of the forest are attacking. April reads the first line, but like shit's kind of going to hell. And just when things are about to at their darkest, she gets stabbed in the back by one of the hands. It was a hand of the witch. Was it a hand of the witch, or was it the same hand?
It was her mom.
Bruce Campbell's hand, I think.
Was it Bruce Campbell's?
I thought it was Bruce Campbell's, but it could have been the mom's.
I thought it was her mom's hand that they show it getting cut off.
I thought it was a severed hand.
Either way, she gets stabbed in the back.
Luke Skywalker's hand.
She's not able to open the Fortnite rift, but she, at the very last second, whispers the words. Okay, first of all, does he have a gray streak in his hair, or is it the lighting?
Yes,
I kept going back and forth.
He has
I can't
a gray
tell.
Streak.
Gray streak.
He's so terrified of what he sees, he gets a gray streak in his hair.
Is that because Sam Raimi knew the next movie wasn't coming out for like 12 years, so he needed to age him a little bit? Or
what?
Was it really that long in between movies?
I thought it was like 5 or 6.
Find out next year on Spooky.
You're probably right.
I mean, okay, so yeah, so then he gets
it's
sucked
5 years
into,
later.
We talked about, good call. We still get sucked into the past. The prophecy has come true. Some like
goes to the Crusades.
Deadite, yeah, like a deadite flies up to him and he shotguns it at the last second, and then they hail him as his king and he screams no. Anything else from that final? We breezed over a lot there, from the Ents all the way up to the Renaissance, whatever it is, anything that
what
stuck
about
out
the
to
giant
you guys?
Head that was trying to eat.
Yeah, him. Dude, that thing was nasty.
The one that looks like Red Skull mixed with a snake.
Yes.
Yeah. Looks like the heads in Mario Brothers 2 that like came off the wall and chased you. Anybody?
We have a young audience, Brett.
Like they get shot out of the thing that went whoop. Would get shot out?
No, they're like the sun things that.
Or were they like fairy looking things?
Oh man, you like go
the
down
sun.
You go down into.
Just send
a thing.
Picture of the. Just send a picture of the group thread again and dear all the pods.
After I don't. Yeah. I thought Josh would know what I was talking about.
I think you have your Mario references switched.
I don't, but
the sun is definitely
no,
in the
not
third
a sun.
One.
It's like a little
the
mask.
Sun that
talk about a
you.
Bone Goomba.
It's like you go down into the pot. Like the
toad
head? No.
Oh, yeah,
yeah,
you're in
the
desert.
Bone Goomba?
You go in
yeah, the
face.
Desert ones.
Gotcha. Yeah, it's a little mask, guys. Get with it.
Thank you, Brett. Anybody else?
Top notch.
Any final thoughts on the last part?
We're all like, I think everyone is an IU grad. Oh, minus Stevie. So... The Michigan
Sorry.
State reference at the beginning, kind of like in the first movie, was pretty cool, but also hate Michigan State, so it kind of sucked. Just want to point that out.
She does get murdered, so...
It's like it was a Purdue reference.
She's wearing, like, panties and then a long-sleeve shirt with also a Michigan State t-shirt over the top of that.
She's a freshman. Bruce Campbell is a senior. Bruce Campbell's a senior.
Bruce Campbell's a professor, and she's a...
Oh, yeah, for
oh,
sure.
All right, any other final thoughts? I have here that this was actually funded by Stephen King, in part. He had the quote on the first movie poster that we mentioned, but they were having trouble procuring the funds to make this movie, and Stephen King jumped in and helped to pay for it.
Yeah. Was that alcohol Stephen King or cocaine Stephen King?
This is coke Stephen King, baby. 80s Stephen
this
King.
This is coke Stephen King. All right. I just wanted to make sure.
Ric Flair, Stephen King.
Wasn't that night at the end Sam Raimi?
Yeah, it was. It was the first night to approach him.
What's the explanation for deadites flying around in olden times? Like in this movie, it's because they
There's
open up
There's evil there, Brett.
Okay, I'm not criticizing, I'm asking.
You're going to have to stick around for Army of Darkness.
Yeah, I just don't know why Brett thinks he knows what was flying around several hundred years ago.
Well, he just posted a GIF from several hundred years ago, so...
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything's possible.
I am that old.
I don't remember seeing it.
I am a Highlander. Why won't anybody fight me?
Let's get into yes or no's. One last quick shout out to The Gore the Merrier, which is the name of the Evil Dead 2 making of documentary. The Gore the Merrier. I love that. But Brett, let's get out of the way.
Well, first of all, I wasn't going to like go through this movie and pod just rip on the movie. I'm not like that, but you kind of forced me to do that.
I like when you do that.
No, I usually like movies. I also want to apologize for my audio. I did not plug my microphone in. Sorry, fans. This is
yeah, and you texted me about it right at the beginning of the podcast. I was like all stressed out, and then I'm like, "Is it recording?" And then you didn't answer for 5 minutes, so I was extra stressed out. I'm trying to host.
I was quiet for, like, Brett. Quiet for the first 20 minutes because I was trying to figure it out.
We delete Brett's track anyway.
Sadly, is a no for me.
His mics are set up earlier in the are set up elsewhere in the bedroom.
Boom, boom, boom. I just didn't plug it in.
At least Brett wasn't making popcorn this time. It's all good.
Brett, it's a no.
I said talked over. Yeah, sadly, it's a no. It wasn't entertaining enough to fall on the so bad it's good. I didn't find it funny, like, at all. Sorry.
No, don't, Brett, you don't have to apologize to me. You just have to apologize to everyone who listens to this podcast and hates you now.
I like Bruce Campbell, though.
Well, were you
Bruce
surprised,
Campbell
Brett?
Will listen.
Sorry, real quick, Brett, were you surprised by how much this is loved on Letterboxd? Like, this is like a 4.4 or something crazy. It's got like, so many 5-star reviews.
I was,
and
I saw, like, it got like 100 review. What's-His-Face from Chicago gave it like an 80. On my DirecTV, it said it had 98% of Rotten Tomatoes. So I don't know. I guess I expected more. If I would have known that, maybe it would have been different, but probably not.
Brett the Contrarian.
Stevie, you yes or no?
Well, can you let everybody else go first? I'll go at the end before you.
No, you're next on my list.
Oh.
Fine. I absolutely love this movie. This is like everyone's dreams who loves movies, which is to go out and make I wouldn't say like a small budget film, but a lower budget film with all your best friends. I mean, it sounds like the honest dream. That's what they did. These movies are fun to watch. And I think it was Jordan brought up a good point. Like the shifts, like there's like a tonal shift halfway through the movie where it becomes much more comedic. And it really filters into Army of Darkness nice if you watch them back to back, where it's just all comedy and action. I just like campy B movies, especially from the 80s. So this is a hell yes. I love this trilogy.
So we're at one no, one yes. I'll chime in with my yes. I think actually, Steve, you touched on what I had written down that like I'm rooting for Sam Raimi after watching like the first one, which is just straight up a student low budget film.
Yeah.
And then see him make this, and then to know he goes on to become like a mega millionaire and make superhero movies. That's pretty cool. And it's just a kind of guy you root for. And I think that what really bothered me about Brett's half a star review is that if nothing else, even if you hate this kind of movie, even if you hate like the campiness and everything, the camera work cannot be denied is brilliant. The camera movements, the shots, the whip pans, the cuts, everything that's done with the camera, whether you appreciate it or not, it's really well crafted.
I moved it up to one star, by the way.
Well, that's good to hear. So.
Oh.
Wow. Letterboxd appreciates your input.
No backbone.
Yes for me. Mikey, you have a Letterboxd. What did you give this?
I want to know Mikey's theory. What's Mikey's theory?
He said
we already said. It was the same as Pappy's, where he thinks he murders
these
people are demons and he murders them.
I stole his thunder.
Yeah, I have a Letterboxd, and I gave this like a 4.5 stars, I think. And yeah, I love this movie because it's fun and it's gory and there's lots of funny kills and funny moments. And like Pap said, there's lots of crazy camera tricks and camera movement and stuff like that, which isn't in every movie. Like, the reason this movie is so much fun is because it is low budget and they take a lot of risks that low budget movies have to take. Because they have no other way of getting a point across or getting a shot, or they got to get inventive with stuff. So these kind of movies take a lot of fun risks. And Sam Raimi, he made Spider-Man 3, which is a shitty movie, but these movies are really fun. So
Spider-Man 2 is one of the greatest superhero movies ever made.
Yeah, Spider-Man 2 is awesome. But yeah, I like this movie. I like this whole trilogy, so I give it a yes.
3 yes, 1 no. Jordan, who hails from North Carolina, where do you land?
I mean, as we mentioned earlier, all proceeds from the pod going to Florence victims.
Heaven for Devin.
Heaven for Devin.
It's so dark that you say that. We have no proceeds.
We're at literally all -$150.
If we did make money.
We would reimburse Pappy for carrying the pod on his back for the last 2 years.
All profits from the pod.
All proceeds go to Heaven for Devin recovery fund.
This is one of the weirdest kind of experiences with a movie that I've had for this podcast, I think, because the first 45 minutes of this movie, probably I was pissed. I hated Evil Dead 1, and I really didn't like the first half of this movie. The second half had me laughing quite a bit, but it's still going to be a no, just because was that snaps back there, Brett?
Were you rooting for this movie to fail on the pod, Brett?
Oh, no, that like you Brett can't relate snaps. To that, Stevie.
Brett is the underminer from Incredible.
Brett snapping is the most pompous thing I've ever heard in my life.
Yeah, I don't know. I think the campiness or whatever of the first half of the movie doesn't quite get redeemed in the second half. It all is a little dumb, even though I had some good laughs in there. So it's a soft no.
3-2, Josh. It comes down to you.
Well, this is one of the movies that kind of comes down the middle for me. I, like Jordan, hated the first one with no plot. This one, at the beginning, I was starting to hate a lot, and just knowing that, like, you and especially Stevie liked it a lot, I really wanted to hate this really bad. But ultimately, I think what you said, Pappy, about all the, like, I don't think it's well-crafted, necessarily, everything they do with all the camera movement and all the tricks, but I do love, like, I don't know if there's another movie with this much variety of type of camera shots, tricks, moments, and sure, the plot falls apart, but, like, the movie knows that the plot is falling apart, and it's a fun movie to watch. It's hard for me to say that I'd recommend it to everyone I saw, but for me, it did become a enjoyable movie by the end, and the ending is so weird after Groovy and then, like, through the portal, and it ends on, like, this really strange, not cliche note that the first one did. It had me won over by the end, and I'm sorry, I thought it was Evil Dead 3, Army of Darkness.
Have you seen Army of Darkness, though?
Yes.
Nice.
It's 4-3. Josh, what kind of food is that?
It's 4-2.
4-2. Sorry, my fingers...
And I think that's a pickle, Rick.
That's a baked potato.
Pickle Rick. All right.
Oh, yeah. It's got to be a potato thing.
It's got to be a potato.
A baked potato with some slightly
like a warmed
old,
up
old sour cream.
It's like a microwave.
Like, when did, curdled sour cream. When did potatoes not be tasty? Why is that like something to make fun of people for? Oh, God. Brett likes potatoes.
Let's have a quick PSA,
oh, my gosh.
Because I think Stevie could really help.
Okay, PSA potatoes. For the audience. Brett is Irish.
I'm just saying Stevie, with his knowledge, could help some of the audience health if he dropped the knowledge.
If y'all out there eating potatoes, stop. You'll live longer.
Hey, go drink a bunch of beer, though. You'll be all right.
All right.
Yeah.
From the corrections department, we have a YouTube comment from a rando, actually a person not a friend of the pod, Cudado. This is on the Highlander episode hosted by Stevie. Entertaining app. I have a few thoughts, though. Canon had nothing to do with the production or making of this film. They were only the distributors, and he cites a source. The film print they've used for most of the home releases just happens to have the logo, so it's been kept into most of the digital releases. Second point he makes, Braveheart has armies meeting in battle. This was only 2 clans/villages clashing. Not really a fair comparison. Third point he makes, CGI in 1986. Please, I don't think so. More like practical and hand-painted animated effects. And last point he makes, no mention of the duel at Boston Common, for shame, smiley face. You know, I felt like you, like, shook my hand and kicked me in the dick there, Cuidado. You're like,
oh, yeah, for sure. 100%.
That was fun, but let me tell you why it sucked.
Maybe he could talk about it on his
podcast.
Well,
in all fairness, we don't know anything about movies.
No, I appreciate the feedback.
Yeah, me too.
You guys can listen on YouTube. And I'm glad that we righted the wrong, so our legion of listeners who listened to both those episodes won't have that misconception. Another quick feedback. Instagram. I just thought this comment was worth reading on the podcast. Stevie, Bone Tomahawk had the best trivia segment. Salty Josh, LOL. That's from our friend Kylo Rem's memes. Kylo
really? Rem's memes.
Bone
they
Tomahawk,
like the trivia?
Best trivia, Salty Josh, LOL. And Josh was salty.
Salty that is taters. Awesome. I'm glad people like tag it. That's awesome.
No,
speaking
salty
of
taters.
Trivia. Speaking of trivia, I'm wheeling out the spoilers, spooky spoilers trivia board. For those of you listening at home, it's a giant board that looks like the Jeopardy board, except it's orange. It's got 69 spooky questions on it. Brett, do you know why I picked 69 questions?
Just a great number, I guess.
It's the year of Woodstock, Brett.
Yeah, I was
because I couldn't come up with 420 questions, Brett. That's why. So here are the rules. Two strikes, you're out, but you get one 50-50 and one pass. So you can pass a question on the next person. These
such
are
intricate.
Multiple choice. The order is Mikey. Or sorry, excuse me. The order is Josh, Brett, Stevie, Jordan, Mikey. Mikey, you can make any adjustments to this order you'd like because you are the most longest since you've hosted.
Mikey, what was the last episode you hosted?
I don't know.
Wasn't that in July?
Mikey, for reference, Jordan. Mikey,
no,
Jordan,
I'm not going to mess with the order.
Not messing. I like it.
So what?
Josh,
break of the order.
150-50, one
Josh,
pass, and
that's it. 150-50, one pass, and one strike.
And so your second strike is you're done.
Okay,
so.
Cool.
You're
Thank
done.
You.
So you're out. All right, Josh, Brett, Stevie, Jordan, Mikey.
To the games.
Let's roll through these.
Baseball.
Josh, your first question: how many
Got
species
it.
Of bat are known? 12, 120. 1,200 or 12,000?
Were there bats in this movie?
No, it's just spooky questions. I googled things about Halloween. Incorrect. That's a first strike. Doesn't use a lifeline. Horrible strategy. It was 1,200 bats are known. Brett.
Yes.
Wow.
Josh has a strike.
A lot of bats.
Sherlock Holmes is the most portrayed character in the history of television and movies combined. What spooky character is number one in movies alone? Is it A, Frankenstein, B, Hamlet, C, Dracula, or D, Jesus Christ?
Are you saying Jesus Christ is spooky?
He's a zombie.
So spooky.
He rose from the dead.
You said he's a spooky character?
Which is the number one character in the history of movies?
He's a
most
ghostly
movies,
spirit.
Most appearances. Frankenstein, Hamlet, Dracula, or Jesus.
What is Hamlet? Is Hamlet scary? I'm
yeah,
so
he's
uneducated.
He's
I don't
he
know.
He comes back as a ghost, man.
Brett, I'll do a 50-50.
All right. It's not Hamlet and it's not Jesus. Is it Frankenstein or Dracula?
Dracula.
Correct. Brett has used
you
his 50-50.
Should have said it's either Dracula or Jesus. That would have been a trick question.
Oh, jeez.
All right. Stevie, how many victims did Jeffrey Dahmer claim? Is it A, 7, B, 10? C, 13, D, 17. Jeffrey Dahmer, cannibal.
Yeah.
7, 10, 13, 17.
That's a dude from Wisconsin?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think he was in Milwaukee. Ah, give me a 50-50.
It's not 7, it's not 10. It's either 13 or 17.
Ooh. So it's a lot.
It's quite a bit.
Nom.
I think they awarded like $134 million to the families, but they couldn't pay it. So let's go with 17.
Correct. Good job. Stevie uses his 50-50. Jordan, what film topped AFI's 100 Years, 100 Thrills list? Is it A, Jaws, B, The Exorcist, C, The Silence of the Lambs, or D, Psycho? 100 Years, 100 Thrills from the American
that
Film Institute.
That's
a tough one.
That is a
Pass.
Tough one.
All right, that goes to Mikey. You can also
Son
pass.
Of a
you
bitch.
Can pass. You can pass a pass. It's It's a very important part of the game.
Yeah, I'll pass. I'll pass that pass.
The pass has been passed to Josh. Josh,
I'll pass it to you to the left-hand side.
What film topped the AFI's 100 Years, 100 Thrills list? Jaws, The Exorcist, The Silence of the Lambs, or Psycho? Josh has all of his lifelines. And one strike.
Pass.
Oh, God.
Okay, so
Brett,
don't do
what
this.
What film topped the AFI's 100 Years, 100 Thrills list? Jaws, Exorcist.
Get it to go all the way back to Jordan.
So that's the left Psycho. Brett.
I want to pass, but I think I know the answer.
50-50s in a row.
Pass it.
Go for it.
I think the answer
If he misses, can I go ahead?
Sure. No. No, there's no steals. It's just not strikes.
I believe the answer is Psycho.
And the answer Brett gave is correct. Bold.
Wow.
Bold play.
Ballsy choice.
Very hands impressed. Off the keyboard, Brett.
So, Stevie, now it goes to you. How many films did Bela Lugosi appear in? Is it A53, B103, C153, or D203?
Wow. All of those are crazy.
Wow. He was the original Dracula, right?
Mm-hmm. And he's also parodied in Ed Wood. Great movie. Sad guy. 53, 103, 153, 203.
203.
I'm sorry, Steve. That's your first strike. It was 103.
Such a bullshit question.
Jordan, according to pumpkinnook.com, I'm sorry. Approximately.
Get the source right.
How big was the biggest pumpkin ever grown? Was it A, 1,100 pounds, B, 3,200 pounds? Sorry, I don't know why these aren't in order. It's A, 1,100 pounds, B, 3,200 pounds. C, 2,600 pounds, or D, 1,500 pounds. What the fuck? Okay.
Can you say them again? No, I just need to write them down.
Okay. 1,100,
3,200,
2,600, or 1,500 pounds? Biggest pumpkin. 11, 32, 26, or 1,500
pounds. Jesus. The biggest
pumpkin? You have your 50-50, right?
Is this including the great pumpkin?
Mm-hmm. This may have been the Great Pumpkin or the Carriage Pumpkin from that movie from Disney.
Mm.
Cinderella.
1,100.
That's unfortunately not correct. It's 2,600. That's the
point.
Damn!
Is that your first strike, Jordan? I need you guys to keep track of this.
Yeah, it is. I'm trying to keep track too.
All right, Mikey, which of these is the highest rated horror film on Letterboxd? Or which of these is the highest rated? A, Get Out. B, The Shining. C, Psycho. D, Alien. As rated by the users on Letterboxd. Get Out, The Shining, Psycho, Alien.
The Shining.
Incorrect. I think Mikey, ooh, is that two strikes?
That's what I would have said. Yeah.
It's one.
Good guess.
That's just one frame, isn't it?
That's one strike, sorry. Yeah.
First strike.
Yeah, he passed. It's Psycho was the right answer. Psycho.
Can we get a handle on
Psycho? Psycho, two answers tonight.
Can we get a handle on passes and 50-50s here?
Yeah. What's everybody got?
I have
Josh,
I have a pass 50-50. Left and I have a strike.
I have zero strikes and a pass left.
Josh?
One strike, 50-50.
Stevie, I've got one strike and a 50-50 left. I think Mikey has the same.
Strike and a 50-50.
Okay. Cool.
Josh, back to you. In what year was the horror production Blumhouse company founded? Is it A, 1995, B, 2000, C, 2005, or D, 2010?
City.
Let's go 2000 or 2005.
Oh, I'd have missed it.
2000.
In the year 2000. That's correct.
Oh.
Oh, I just like
one
moved
more
my thing.
Day.
Okay, there it is. All right. Brett.
Yep.
What is the world record for the largest gathering of witches? Is it A, 1,607? B, 11,607? C, 21,607? Or D, 31,607 spooky witches all gathered together?
Jeez.
spooky cat ladies all gathered together.
I will pass.
Stevie, world record for witches. No, he hasn't used it. 1,607.
Pass.
Okay. Oh, fuck.
Jordan.
Ooh. Can you say the numbers again?
I'm not going out on a question like that.
Yeah.
1,607. 11,607. 21,607. 31,607.
50-50.
Is it 31,607 or 1,607?
Oh, wow.
What? Can you say the question again?
What largest is the gathering world of witches, record Jordan? For spooky witches all gathered in one place together?
You gotta be shitting me.
To be fair, Pappy doesn't know if they're spooky or not. That's editorializing.
I saw the article. These are all hand researched by Pappy.
So they're greasy. They're all greasy. Yeah, so
these are bullshit 2017 questions.
Much pap grease.
I heard there was a big witch gathering this year, actually, since you made these questions. The lower one.
Correct. 1,607. You can't get 31,000 witches together. You know what would happen?
It's illegal.
Come on.
That's a pretty spooky place.
That would be too spooky, yeah.
Come on. All right,
I think it's
Mikey.
One of the amendments.
Which of these... come back.
There were... In effort to get to 420, and I gave up and settling on 69, there were some pretty bad questions. And loosely affiliated with Halloween questions, Mikey... Which of these is an actual flavor of Kit Kat you can buy in Japan?
No. Ooh, I might know this.
Spooky! Sushi.
Spooky Japan! Godzilla! Is it A, sushi, B, sake, C, whiskey, or D, underpants?
Okay, 50-50.
Actual flavor of Kit Kat. Is it sake or underpants?
I'm going to go sake.
Correct. I thought you might fall for the old underpants gag.
So I'm back all up out of top. Lifelines.
Got to move my order down. Back up the top at Josh. Which of these costumes was the most popular, according to Cosmopolitan magazine, in the year 1996? A. Ghostface from Scream. B. The Power Rangers. C. Aladdin. Or D. Michael Jordan.
Is Michael Jordan blackface?
How can Jordan be costume?
Wait, I don't know.
When you said Cosmopolitan, I fully expected like sexy cat.
Yeah, well.
What is the actual question though? Which is the most famous costume?
According to Cosmopolitan magazine, which was the most popular costume as far as like units sold or whatever of 1996?
It's gotta be. It's either Power Rangers or Scream. I'll do 50-50. I'm pretty sure Scream was like.
You have 50-50?
I'm going to go Scream. I'm 50-50 in myself, okay. Bro.
All right, sorry.
I'm going to go with Scream.
It's got to be right.
And you would be correct. Nice. It is Ghostface from Scream. Yes, I remember that. That shit was error-aware.
Yeah, that was an easy one. That was a layup.
How fast can the fastest bat fly? I was on the Bat Wikipedia for a while.
Oh, my
How
God.
How fast can the fastest bat fly? Is it A, 75 miles per hour, B, 35, C, 69, or D, 99 miles
69
per hour.
Or
420 miles an hour.
666 miles an hour.
Nice. 75, 35, 69, or 99. The fastest bat.
Bats are pretty fast, yo.
I'll go 69.
And you would be incorrect. It's actually 99 miles
Dang.
An hour.
Oh my
Dang,
lord.
That's fast.
Is that your first strike?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, Stevie, we're up to question 13.
No.
This has been question 13 for 2 years in a row now on the Spooky Spoilers board, and nobody's picked it.
Can we pick it?
Can we choose?
Well, last year we had to be picked. Last year we had you pick the question.
I can't say stuff like that.
This is
budget
fucked,
cuts
dude.
This year. Budget cuts this year. You can't pick.
All proceeds.
Real.
You are the worst ringmaster, but ask the question. Go ahead,
are
please.
Ghosts real? Question 13. Are ghosts real? A, yes. B, not anymore. C, No, D, there are more ghosts than you think.
Dude, that's a subjective question.
Are ghosts real? A, yes. B, not anymore. C, no. D, there are more ghosts than you think.
I refuse to answer it. Pick another one.
That's a thesis fucking question.
You should just answer it because you won't get it wrong.
Not anymore. That's so funny.
I refuse to answer that on principle.
It's
ask
been a
another
free
question.
Pass for 2 years. You'll just get it right. Just pick anything.
Dummy. Pick any question.
And they say me and Josh rig trivia.
Yeah, for real,
fuck
dude.
Yeah, dude, free question.
Mikey could have picked the order, and it's been question 13 for 2 years. I can show you the spreadsheet.
I mean, my experience would say one thing, and my knowledge would say
well, just,
another.
What do you
so
think?
I'll go...
What do you think, Stevie?
No.
Okay, you're sure.
Wow. Right. So Stevie's an
feels
atheist.
Feels a little uncertain.
Wow.
Sorry, close I thought that would be way more fun. Jordan, thought we'd have more fun with that. What was the top grossing spooky film of 2006?
Wait, is he out then, or...
No, he got it right. There's
no
right answer.
I got it right. They're
that's
not real.
Cool, man. What?
It's been a free pass
not
for
anymore.
2 years. Oh, Jesus Christ.
Pappy, hit me with number 14.
Salty Josh trivia. This is what the people talk about, Salty Josh on trivia. What was the top grossing spooky film of 2006? Was it A, The Omen, B, Final Destination, C, Saw? Oh, excuse me. B,
Seesaw?
Final Destination 3, C,
Seesaw?
Saw. Jesus Christ. I'm just going to say A, The Omen, The Omen, Final Destination 3, Saw 3, or Silent Hill? 2006, The Omen, Final Destination 3, Saw 3,
the Omen.
Or Silent Hill. Incorrect.
Fuck.
You're out.
Damn, Saw 3, dog.
It was Saw 3.
Bye, brother.
Mikey, what was
fuck
the top
you, Stevie,
grossing spooky film of 2007? Was it A, 1408, B, Saw, C, 28 Weeks Later, or D, I Am Legend?
Seesaw.
Which Saw is that?
Seesaw.
The first Saw is the choice.
Oh, the first
Saw 4, sorry. Saw 4.
Seesaw.
1408, ooh, Saw 4, 28 Weeks Later, I Am Legend.
I Am Legend.
Correct.
Nice.
Josh, I was really hoping Brett would get this question, but what is the biggest spider web ever discovered? 20
oh, my
feet,
Lanta.
20 feet, 30 feet, 50 feet, or 100 square jeez feet? They're all in square
100
feet!
Come
nope
on, man.
It's 30 feet.
That's two strikes, yeah.
Stevie?
Yeah, he's out.
Brett, how many strikes do you have?
One.
According to Box Office Mojo, which of these films has the highest lifetime gross in the torture category?
Oh,
Saw,
Lord.
Saw 2, Saw 3, or Hostel?
Saw 1, 2, 3, or 4.
Saw 1, 2, 3, Saw 1, 2, 3 or Hostel?
Eyes, nose, arms,
I
or legs.
I will say Saw 3.
It was actually Saw 2.
Ooh.
So who's left? Is it Stevie and Mikey? And Josh?
Yeah.
Josh, I got a free,
Josh
got a free answer.
Out.
Josh, no. Well, Mikey should have switched.
Is there
a
prove it? What if Stevie and Mikey both get out this time?
There's no prove it. Absolutely.
Oh. So if I miss now, Mikey wins?
Which of these celebrities was not born on Halloween? God damn it. I'm going to look really bad now. A, Rob Schneider. B, my grandma Sharon and cousin Carrie. Shout out. C, Vanilla Ice. Or D, Pauly Shore. Who was not born on Halloween?
What the fuck?
Rob Schneider, my grandma, and my cousin Carrie. Vanilla Ice, or Pauly Shore.
What movie was your grandma in?
Rudy.
Oh, okay.
Probably true.
She played Rudy in the movie.
So, Rob Schneider,
my
your
grandma, Sharon.
Your grandma Sharon,
and
your
cousin
Carrie, is that what you said?
Yeah, it's two people.
So confused.
That's one answer, yeah. Or Vanilla Ice or Pauly Shore. Who's not a Halloween birthday?
I hate you so much.
He gave you a free answer last time.
Man. Okay. Let's go with... I don't know about your grandma Sharon and your cousin Carrie. Let's go with Pauly Shore.
Correct, yeah.
Yes!
Wow.
Yeah, my grandma Sharon and cousin Carrie were both born on Halloween. Mikey, top grossing spooky film of 2008. Saw, I Am Legend Again, Prom Night, or Diary of the Dead? Saw 5, excuse me. 2008. Saw 5, I Am Legend,
hates
Prom
the
Night.
Saws.
Ooh, I'm gonna go. Jesus, how many Saw movies are we pumping out nowadays?
Too many.
Saw.
Correct. Yeah, I Am Legend was 2007. It would have been a better trick question if that came first, I guess. But Stevie. Well,
yeah.
It's the order of the cards.
Let's do it.
Yeah, it still made money in 2007. Jason Blum's net worth, 50 mil, 60 mil, 70 mil, 80 mil.
Who?
Jason Blum, founder of Blumhouse Productions.
Duh.
The company that made it.
Duh.
I thought M. Night founded Blumhouse. I didn't know that. Shit. Nope.
Jason Blum.
Jeez. Brett attacking people as he got out. Let me see.
A lot of salty people on trivia tonight.
I know.
I just picked the biggest spider web. I thought that would be epic.
It would be cool.
And right.
Yep.
A low ball, John, the choices.
So 50, 60, 70, 80?
Mil.
Oh, Blumhouse is killing it right now. Let's go with 80.
Mikey is your new trivia host. Hey. 50 mil. All right. Let's 50
mil.
Throw it to Spoiler Man, and we'll come back with Mikey's choice for the movie.
This is a very sad ending.
Spoiler Man here. Our email is podcastspoilers@gmail.com. Twitter is @spoilers_pod. Our Instagram is podcastspoilers. It's lit. Josh Hensley from the Rutabaga wrote our theme song. Our spoilers hotline is 903-776-4507. That's 903-SPOIL-07. Please support this podcast by leaving us an iTunes review. To do this, 1. Search for Movie Spoilers. 2. Click on our orange Spoilers Bowl logo and scroll all the way to the bottom. 3. Leave us some stars and some words. Now you can check us out on Spotify, YouTube, Stitcher, Apple, and Google Podcasts. If you enjoyed what you heard today, subscribe on SoundCloud or iTunes.
Mikey, what's the choice for the movie?
This is a movie I haven't seen, but I've heard a lot about. It's a newer movie, and it's supposedly
tell me it's Hereditary.
Supposedly spooky. It's a movie called It Follows.
Yes.
I don't know if any of you guys have seen that, but it's a spooky movie, I guess. I don't know too much about it.
Looking forward to it, Mikey. Ignore the haters who try to tear down your epic win. And thank you for listening. That was Spoilers.
I'm pumped for Mikey.
It was a fun time.
Good job.
Yeah, you won.
It feels good after a while. Get that monkey off your back.
Get that Mikey off your back.
The sacred texts! The sacred texts!